ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्यं नरं चैव नरोत्तमम् देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासम् ततो जयमुदीरये नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवते उत्तमा श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्टिकी कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंद गोप कुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। ओम अज्ञानतिमिरंधस्य ज्ञानंजनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे।
रीडिंग फ्रॉम द 10th कैंटो चैप्टर नंबर 10 टेक्स्ट नंबर 15। दरिद्रो निरहं स्तंभो मुक्तः सर्वमदैरिह कृच्छ्रं यदृच्छयाप्नोति तद्धि तस्य परं तपः। दरिद्रो निरहं स्तंभो मुक्तः सर्वमदैरिह कृच्छ्रं यदृच्छयाप्नोति तद्धि तस्य परं तपः। दरिद्रो निरहं स्तंभो मुक्तः सर्वमदैरिह कृच्छ्रं यदृच्छयाप्नोति तद्धि तस्य परं तपः।
दरिद्रो निरहं स्तंभो
दरिद्रः अ पॉवर्टी स्ट्रिकन पर्सन, निरहम स्तंभः इज ऑटोमैटिकली फ्रीड फ्रॉम ऑल फॉल्स प्रेस्टीज, मुक्तः लिबरेटेड सर्वमदहि फ्रॉम फॉल्स ईगो, इह इन दिस वर्ल्ड कृच्छ्रम विथ ग्रेट डिफिकल्टी, यद्रिच्छया आपनोति व्हाट ही गेन्स बाय चांस फ्रॉम प्रोविडेंस, तत् दैट ही इंडीड तस्य हिज परम परफेक्ट तपः ऑस्टेरिटी. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace E.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. A poverty-stricken man must automatically undergo austerities and penances because he does not have the wealth to possess anything. Thus his false prestige is vanquished. Always in need of food, shelter and clothing, he must be satisfied with what is obtained by the mercy of Providence. Undergoing such compulsory austerities is good for him because this purifies him and completely frees him from false ego. Purport. A saintly person voluntarily accepts a state of poverty just to become free from material false prestige. Many great kings left their princely standard of living and went to the forest to practice austerity according to the Vedic culture, just to become purified. But if one who cannot voluntarily accept such austerity is put into a situation of poverty, he automatically must practice austerity. Austerity is good for everyone because it frees one from material conditions. Therefore, if one is very much proud of his material position, putting him into poverty is the best way to rectify his foolishness. Daridriya dosho gunarashi nashi. When a person is poverty stricken, naturally his false prestige in aristocracy, wealth, education and beauty is smashed. Thus corrected, he is in the right position for liberation. Hare Krishna. So in this episode of the cursing of Nalakuer and Manigrip, Narad Muni is passing by and he sees the two demigods, Yakshas, Nalakuer and Manigrip, sporting in the water with Apsaras. They are naked, they are drunk, and they don't realize the presence of this great spiritual authority, Narad Muni. So the women, they realize his presence, they cover themselves up. But Nalakuer, Manigrip, they are the sons of Kuvera. They are so intoxicated that they don't realize that they are in the presence of a great Mahatma. So Narada is now contemplating that what must be done in order to bring these foolish, sensual sons of a wealthy father, Kuer, very responsible position, treasurer of the universe, of the gods. How can I teach these spoiled brats some good lesson? So that is Narada's contemplation. And here, this is Narada's contemplation. That how, what is the principle which works behind a person getting some good spiritual lessons. How does a rich man who has forgotten empathy, who has forgotten respect, who has forgotten sense control, how to teach him, such a person, good sense, how to give him some good values? So here is a series of very wonderful verses, principle behind law of karma, behind how things work in this world. And therefore the very series of good verses are there here. Begins with where Narada Muni is thinking. Asataha Shri Madandasya Daridriyam Paramikshati Atmau Pammena Bhutani Daridraha Paramanjanam. So Narada is thinking, Asataha Shri Madandasya, that when a person becomes attached to Shri, to wealth, Srimad, we say Srimad, Bhagavat, Bhagavat. Mad means what? Mad means intoxication. So, when we say Srimad, Bhagavat, this is also an intoxication. Devotees are intoxicated to reading Srimad Bhagavatam, to the association of devotees, to chanting Hare Krishna. This is also an intoxication. So, when a person is not attached to the positive things, asataha, and if a person is attached to something temporary, such as wealth, asataha Shri Madandasya, when it's wrongly directed, his intoxication is wrongly directed, then what do you do to such a person? Daridriyam param ikshate. So Narada's thinking that intoxication causes a kind of blindness. A person is not able to see. So ikshate means eyes. So for a wealthy person who's puffed up, who's intoxicated to wealth, Daridriyam Paramikshate. Atmau Pamyena Bhutani Daridraha Paramanjanam. And then when he is in a lower position, then he is able to respect everybody. And Daridraha Paramanjanam, it is a wonderful ointment. It's like eye disease. When you have an eye disease like sore eyes, especially in this season, it is explained that it is said that sore eyes is common. So it's contagious. So when you have sore eyes, you put eye drops. So for a man who is intoxicated with false pride, with his wealth, for such a person, Daridriyam Paramanjanam is the greatest. So then Narada is saying, Yatha kantaka vidango jantor nechadi tam yatham jiva samyam gato linge natatha vida kantaka. What is the problem with wealthy people? Problem is that they don't have empathy. They have all luxuries, comforts. They don't feel enough for others, the troubles which people have gone through. They don't feel that. They don't have empathy. So therefore, it is explained by an example. Yatha kantaka vidango jantor na ichchadi tam vyatham jiva samyam gato linge na tatha veda kantaka. When you are pricked by a thorn, you know how much it pains. So such a person does not wish the same pain for others. So if a wealthy man is not considerate for others' position, for underprivileged people, and if he does not care for such a person, then that person is made to become a poverty-stricken person and experience the suffering, so that now he realizes and he does not wish such a situation for others. And then when he comes to a privileged position, he can actually do some good for others, for the society and for himself. Daridro niraham sthambo mukta sarva madairiha कृच्छ्रम यदृच्छयाप्नोति तद्धि तस्य परम तपः। दरिद्रो निरहम स्तंभो, दैट अ पर्सन व्हेन ही इज पॉवर्टी स्ट्रिकन, व्हेन ही इज दरिद्र, देन ही बिकम्स फ्री फ्रॉम ऑल फॉल्स प्रेस्टीज, देन ही डज नॉट हैव एनी ईगो, बिकॉज आउट ऑफ ऑल द ऑपुलेंसेस, जन्म ऐश्वर्य श्रुत श्री भीरे दमान मध पुमान, द मध द इंटॉक्सिकेशन ऑफ वेल्थ इज द हाइएस्ट। Person may be beautiful. A person may be intelligent. Person may be famous. Person may be strong. Person may be knowledgeable. Person may be renounced, but person if he is rich, that's the problem. His intoxication is complete, because if a person is wealthy, then he can get everything. Everything he can make available for his sense enjoyment. He does not need to depend on others. He has everything. Why does he need anybody? So a wealthy person, coming from wealthy backgrounds, rich people's children are generally sensual. And therefore, daridro nirham sthambo mukta sarva madheriha. He is completely freed from all his intoxication. Krichram yadrichayapnoti. And with great difficulty, Yadrichaya apnoti, whatever comes on its own accord, he learns to depend on God, learns to depend on others. Taddhi tasya param tapaha, and he learns what is austerity. Automatically he is forced. A person who is born in a poverty stricken family, he's naturally austere. What wealthy people may have to give up to go to the forest to experience, to do tapasya, a poverty stricken man is already doing it. कृच्छ्रम यदृच्छया आपनोति तद्धि तस्य परम तपः। नित्यं क्षुत्क्षामदेहस्य दरिद्रस्य अन्नकांक्षिणः। इंद्रियाणि अनुशुष्यन्ति हिंसापि विनिवर्तते। व्हाट हैपेंस, नित्यं क्षुत्क्षामदेहस्य, ही इज ऑलवेज हंग्री, he is always in need for food, clothing, shelter. So his senses, indriyani anushushyanti, his senses become weak. Like we may fast on ekadashi, nirjal ekadashi, and we have observed that when we are fasting, our senses are so weak, we can't think of any sense gratification. Only one sense gratification we can think of, food. There is no other sense gratification we can think of. So, the other senses become subdued. Indriyani anuhushyanti hinsapi vanivartante. And naturally when your senses are weak, you cannot be offensive. You cannot be violent. You have no strength in your body. So naturally a violent person, an aggressive person, an arrogant person will become humbled. And another great advantage, it is explained, दरिद्रस्यैव युज्यन्ते साधव समदर्शिनः, सद्भिः शृणोति तद्दर्शम् तथा सद्य आराध्यते तथा आराध्य शुद्यते। दैट व्हेन अ पर्सन इज पॉवर्टी स्ट्रिकन, ही इज मोर फॉर्चुनेट। व्हेन अ पर्सन इज पॉवर्टी स्ट्रिकन, देयर आर मोर चांसेस फॉर हिम टू गेट द एसोसिएशन ऑफ सेंटली पीपल, इज इट नॉट? इट्स बीन सीन लाइक दैट। So he becomes more fortunate, because by the association of a devotee, then naturally they learn good lessons and they can advance. Sadhu sangha they get. But if you see the wealthy people, they have a dog at their doorsteps, and they have so many securities, and it's very difficult for any devotee to go and, you know, maybe preach to such a person, because they're always guarding themselves with so many securities. So that is the psychology which goes behind it. Because it's natural that wealthy people, they tend to become sensual. And it may seem that Narada is very, he's very violent, he's very angry, and he's very ruthless. That he's coming and he's cursing them to become trees, and they all end up becoming trees. They get cursed, Narada curses them, and they become trees. So ruthless. But actually it's quite interesting Because just recently I was, not recently, in fact about a year ago or something, I was speaking with one friend of mine who is working in the police. And he once came to me for some guidance. And he was asking me, Prabhu, you know, I am posted in Bandra. Havaldar is posted in Bandra. And I have to do, I'm security in that place. So, you know, many times I have to catch people. You know, boys and girls, young boys and girls in their cars, bandstand in that area, all the cars are parked, and in the cars, boys and girls are openly, you know, engaging in illicit relationships. And he says that I have to go and stop them. I have to bang on the car and take them out. And many times they are not clothed. They don't have any clothes in them. And I tell them, come, jail mein chalo. Under arrest. So I told them, but why do you arrest them? I mean, is it a law or what? I mean, if they want, let them do it. Or what's the problem? He says, no. I said, it's a law that you cannot do these things in the open. Even today, if anybody wants to do it, you should go home. Do it at home, not in the open. So, in the age of Kali Yuga, this law is applicable. And I was amazed to hear that you cannot do these things in the open. Even today, in such a degraded age of Kali Yuga, the government has a law that if you do it openly, you are going to be arrested. At least in India, fortunately, there is this law. So, that's the principle. And he was saying, but what to do, Prabhu? So I said, what's your problem? He said, the problem is that they tell me that please don't arrest me. If you want, you can also join us. And then he said that, well, how to control senses, Prabhu? Because they're coming from such wealthy background, they're so good looking and everything, they said that you cannot imagine that such people can be engaged in such frivolous and abominable animalistic activity. And I agreed, I said, yeah, that's right, I mean, it's difficult. What is the solution for that? I just said, come back and chant your rounds properly, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. So difficult, you know, to do your duties. But Narada was not affected by the situation. He was not at all affected. He thought, how can I rectify the situation? I'm not affected by that. So that is the idea, is that Narada is not being cruel. He's applying the law of God, religion, according to time, place and circumstance. According to the law, these two entities, Nalakuer, Manigreve, would have become trees in their next life and gone through a very large period of time in their body of trees and finally going up to the higher species and coming to the human form of life. But because Narada cursed them, they became trees in the courtyard of the son of Nanda, Shri Krishna. And they got the association of Lord Shri Krishna and they immediately got bhakti. They got devotion unto Lord Shri Krishna. So what Narada did was not cruel. What Narada, a great saint, did was actually an act of compassion. It was not cruel at all. And therefore he was just applying the laws of religion, religious principles. Nobody is exempted from this law. Everybody is applicable. Bhagavatam says that. Tebhya pitribhyastat putra devadanava guhyakaha manushyaha siddha gandharvaha savidhyadar charanaha kindeva kinnara naga rakshah kim purushadeha yesham prakriti yesham bhutani prakriti patayastadha rajasattvattamo bhuvah yabir bhutani vidhyante bhutanam patayastadha that chitra vache shravantihi that all these species savidhyadara charanaha manushyaha siddha gandharvaha rakshaha kimpurushade all these people are applicable Chitra, Vacha, Shravantihi, the laws, all sons of Bhrigu, they have all descended from the sons of Bhrigu. And they have bound by the laws of God. Nobody is exempted. Everybody has to go through this process. Everybody has to abide by the law. And he's only making it. And therefore it may seem cruel. And Narada is who? Guru. Narada is spiritual master of the world. Jagat Guru. Spiritual master is the representative of Bhagavan, Baladev. Baladev is carrying, what is he carrying? Hull. A plow. And actually, spiritual master's duty is to do that, to plow, irrigate, to kind of churn. So, in Hindi, we say hal. Hal means what? Hal means, like you say, are mushkil mein yaar, thoda hal kar de. Give me a solution. So, it's like that. So, Guru is supposed to give us a solution. So, the hal, what does the hal do? So, the Guru will actually churn the heart. He will actually plow the field, cultivate the field of the heart. That would be painful. Because when you plow the field, when you plow the land, you are digging the earth for that matter. In that sense. So what is inside, you're taking it out. And it could be a very cumbersome, a very painful process. So when the Guru is plowing the heart, it is quite painful in that sense. Tears may come from the eyes, may perspire. I was seeing a devotee is doing yoga in the morning and they're perspiring. So yoga, sadhana, and following the instructions of the Guru is like perspiration, the tears. That is the irrigation for the... And the field, the what is being sown is a holy name. So when that happens, then only the fruit of Krishna Bhakti sprouts within the heart. And that is the role of Guru, what he does. He ensures that somehow or another devotee comes to the right standard, whether it may be difficult, through a difficult process or through an easy process. So that process of plowing the heart is done by the Guru for the disciple. And nobody should escape that. And the Lord also does that. Lord also sees who is proud, he brings them down. Who is humble, he brings them up. Recently Gopinath Prabhu was discussing from this episode of Romaharishana. Romaharishana was sitting on the Vyasasana, he was speaking Bhagavat. Baldev comes, he does not give him respect. He was so proud, or rather he did not notice him. So Baldev took a blade of grass and touched his body and killed him. He was not an asura, he was a Bhagavat speaker. And he said, Rishair Bhagavato Bhutva Shishwa Ditya Bahunicha Setihasa Puranani Dharma Shastrani Sarvashaha Adantasya Vinitasya Vritha Pandita Mananaha Nagunaya Bhavantisma Natasseva Jitatmanaha. You are maybe the disciple of the great sage Vyasadev. You have memorized all the verses, all the shastras, dharma shastras, puranas. But adantasya vinitasya, you have not controlled your senses, you have not subdued your senses. Adantasya vinitasya vritha pandita manina, you are thinking yourself great scholar. Na gunaya bhavanti sma, but you have not developed a tinge of humility. Natasseva jitatmana, you are an actor. You are a dramatist, nothing else. Took a grass, touched his body, killed him. And on the other hand, we can see in the lives of great saints like Dhruva Maharaj, who was just 5 years old. He spent his time in devotional service and humbly he presented his case to the Lord. The Lord appeared. Satam vipukshanta matad vidam hari nyatvasa sarvas sarid avastitaha kritanjalim brahma mayena kambuna pasparsh balam kripaya kapole. When the Lord appeared in front of Dhruva Maharaj, he did not know what to do. He did not have any words to speak because he was an illiterate. He was a 5-year-old boy, he had not even gone to school. He did not know much. So the Lord is standing in front of him, appeared in front of him, and he's speechless. He does not know what to do. So the Lord, seeing him, was folding his hand and supplicating in a humble mood, "O Lord, I want to glorify you, but I don't have any knowledge, so please help me." And the Lord, Savai Tadaiva Pratipaditam Giram Devim Parijnata Paratmani Rinaya Tam Bhakti Bhavo Bhigranat Asat Param Parishrutoru Dhuvakshitihi. He becomes a great scholar. Just by the touch of the conch of the Lord on his head, he becomes the greatest Vedantist. 5-year-old boy becomes the greatest scholar. Understands the conclusion of all the Vedas, and from his mouth comes one of the greatest glorifications of the Lord. Yontah pravishta mama vacha imam prasuptam anyamscha hasta. He says, anyamscha hasta charanam shravanatvagadin sanjeevayat akhila dhamnis. He says that all you have entered into my senses and you have empowered them. Pranams namo bhagavate purushaya tubhya. That you have empowered me to speak. Whatever I am speaking is your empowerment. So the Lord is pulling down somebody and the Lord is empowering somebody. So that is the Lord's arrangement. So why is he doing that? Because he wants to show, that as Prabhupada writes in the purport, that in a humbled state of consciousness, a person can actually understand what is liberation. Srimad Bhagavat. Understand Srimad Bhagavat, we have to become free from the intoxication of material sense gratification. Bhagavat. Bhagavata. Bha means bhakti. Ga means jnana. Va means what? Vairagya. Ma means mukti. Some people translate like that. So, if you want to become free from the materialistic sense intoxication, sense gratification, you have to be intoxicated with bhakti. Srimad Bhagavat. You cannot become free from intoxication per se, but only you have to change your intoxication from being intoxicated from materialistic things to become intoxicated with spiritual subject matters. And the Lord is always ensuring that, to see that a person does not become falsely intoxicated. Brahmaji, in the dawn of creation, when Brahma was born from the lotus, he was given the knowledge of Vedas. Krishna blew the flute and he was given the knowledge of the Vedas. And Brahma became a little proud that, oh, I am the creator, I'm going to create the world. So then the Lord immediately, from the drops of water on the lotus on which he was born, two demons, Madhu and Kaitab, were created. Just because Brahma can realize what is his position. And these two demons, they immediately stole the Vedas and took it under the ocean and kept it there. And then Brahma, when he woke up, his hard disk was empty. He did not have that knowledge. His hard disk had completely been deleted. So he was like, had to go to Krishna for that knowledge. And the Lord then appeared in the form of Hayagriva. Hayagriva. Haya means horse. Griva means neck. Appeared in that form. Retrieved the Vedas. Killed Madhu and Kaitab. And gave the knowledge to Brahma. And then he came back to his senses. There's a nice pastime of in the Mahabharata explaining the story of one Yaksha. Because Nalukuver are Yaksha. Nalukuver, they are Yaksha from the Yaksha race. It's children of Kuver. So one such Yaksha, during certain time when all the gods assembled together, and they all thought, we will have to do something because so much of demonic propensities, demonic elements are increasing, that we must go to Lord Brahma and request for solution. So they went to Brahma, said, please, there's so much of anarchy, so much of demons on this earth planet, please deliver them. Deliver the earth. So Brahma says, I am helpless. Let us go to Lord Vishnu. So when they go to Vishnu to summon his appearance so that he could take avatar in this world, so one Yaksha appears on the scene. And he says, what is the need for Lord Vishnu to appear? I myself am enough to annihilate all the demons. There is no need for the Lord to appear. I am sufficient. So Brahma looks at this Yaksha and he says, You foolish, arrogant fool. I curse you that you also take birth when the Lord incarnates. And before all the demons are annihilated, you will be annihilated. Because sometimes false pride may, one may feel that false pride means what? False pride means to be arrogant and to, you know, to insult somebody or to say, look down upon others, to be condescending or whatever. But actually, another flip side of false ego is to think that I can help somebody. Oh, I will be compassionate to you. That is also another flip side. I can guide somebody or I can actually give kripa. That is also false ego. And this Yaksha thought like this. So he appeared in as a grandson of Bhima. His name was Barbarik. In Rajasthan, he is worshipped as Katushyam. So when he was born, he was a Kshatriya and he was he learned the art of warfare from his mother. He worshipped the Lord Shiva and he got a benediction. Lord Shiva gave him 3 arrows, very powerful arrows, and said, these are invincible arrows. You can kill anybody in this world with these arrows. He worshipped Agni. Agni appeared and gave him blessing, gave him a dhanush and said, with this dhanush, you will become invincible. You will be able to kill anybody. No problems. So it becomes very powerful. So when the Mahabharata war was about to begin, Barbarik took blessings from his mother, said, mother, I am going. I want to participate in the war. I want to fight. So the mother said, fine, I bless you. But whose side are you going to fight on? They said, well, I will fight on the side which is weaker. I will take that side. And he comes with his 3 arrows, dhanush, and he's come. So in the meanwhile, Krishna is here. And he's asking, he's planning, he's scheming, how can I protect my devotees? And at the same time, he's thinking that how can I subdue the enemies? So he's asking Bhishma, how long will it take you to fight the war and kill everybody? So he's maybe 40, 30 days. 20 days are sufficient. Asking Drona, he says 25 days. Arjuna, how long will you take to fight the war and finish off the war? Maybe 40 days. Everyone is giving their... making an assessment. And he sees Barbarik there. Barbarik is coming on the way. And he's thinking, who is this? Stops him and he says, changes his disguised as a Brahmana. Krishna goes to him and he says, hey, where are you going? And he says, I am going to fight and participate in the war. Mahabharata, Kurukshetra war. He says, oh, is it? Are you stupid? He says, why? You're going to fight with 3 arrows? Are you crazy or what? He says, no, you don't know the power of these arrows, you Brahmana. He says, what will this arrow do? He says, with the first arrow, I mark all the things I want to kill. With the third arrow, I actually kill all of them, which I have marked with the first arrow. And Krishna says, what about the second arrow? In case I change my mind, something which I have marked, I don't want, I want to unmark them, I use a second arrow. Like in computers, we do that. You want to delete something, you select all and you decide, oh, I don't want to delete this, and you deselect them. That was the technology Barbarik had. So Krishna said, fine, that looks good and impressive. So let's see. Why don't you just demonstrate it? Here is a peepal tree. You remove all the leaves from this and make a garland out of it with your arrow. He said, fine, so be it. And while he was preparing himself, Krishna, just to test him, he removed a leaf and put it under his foot. And Barbarik, he shot his first arrow, it marked all the leaves of the tree and went to the foot of Lord Krishna and is hovering there. And Krishna said, what is this arrow doing here? He says, I think there is a leaf under your foot. You remove your foot, otherwise it will hurt you. And Krishna takes out his foot and zoop, it marks that leaf. And the third arrow leaves and it cuts all through all the leaves and strings it and comes to that arrow, that leaf under his foot, makes a garland out of it and presents it to this Brahman, Krishna. And Krishna is amazed to see this inconceivable power. And he started thinking that how do I protect Pandavas in case, now if this person will come and he'll fight. He asked him, whose side do you want to take, by the way? He's very powerful. So he said, whose side are you going to take? So I'll take weaker side. So Krishna said, weaker side is Pandava side. Yeah? 7 Akshani Senas. Kauravas were 11 Akshani Senas. Oh, so I will take the side of Pandava. Whichever is weaker. Then Krishna thought, weaker. By his power, Kauravas will be defeated in no time. They'll become weaker. Then he'll change sides. Then he'll fight against Pandavas. Pandavas will be destroyed. Ultimately, only he will be left. And if I want to protect anybody, if I take the Pandavas and keep them anywhere, even in Patala Loka, that arrow will search and find out and kill them. There is no way I can protect these Pandavas. So what do I do? So Krishna said, I am a Brahman. Yes, what can I do? I want Dakshina. What can I give? I want your head. Give your head. Because your fighting will be great disadvantage for everybody. Give your head. So what kind of donation is this? Yes. Before the battle, a great Kshatriya must give his life. And this is a donation. And with tears in his eyes, before chopping off his head, he said, but Lord, I ask you for one benediction. I came with the desire to participate in a war. At least give me one desire that let me witness the war. Krishna says, so be it. I will do that. And he cuts his head, gives it to Krishna. He hangs it on a tree adjacent to Kurukshetra, and throughout the 18 days of battle, that head was witnessing everything. At the end of the battle, when Pandavas emerged victorious, a sense of pride comes in everybody's heart, naturally. So the Pandavas also thought that maybe let us know our position, who contributed to the war more, who was responsible for the ultimate victory of the Pandavas. So they went to Krishna and said, how did he fight? What is your opinion? So Krishna said, I don't know because I was so busy. So let's go to ask Barbarik. He's there. He can give witness. So goes to Barbarik, and Barbarik is... And they ask him, and Barbarik says, it was none of you Pandavas. It was only because of Krishna, his supreme will, his Sudarshan Chakra, and his supreme mystical powers due to which you are all protected. You had nothing to do in this war. You are nothing but instruments. It was him who did everything. I am the witness. And that way the Pandavas were humbled. So, we can see that the greatest obstacle to bhakti is ego. And therefore, in this series of verses, Narada is explaining that what do you learn? You learn respect. Respect stands for what? R stands for respect. E stands for empathy. S stands for simplicity. P stands for peacefulness. And E stands for escort. You get an association at devotee. C stands for calmness. And T stands for tolerance, respect. And that is all that a devotee is taught. Krishna wants to teach all these lessons because that is conducive for bhakti. Unless there is no respect, there cannot be devotion. So there are various such pastimes. The father of Nalukuer, Manigreve, also was trapped in such a situation. Kuer and his associate Maniman, both yakshas, one day they were traveling, and Maniman, while they were going in their airplane, they see Agastya Rishi offering prayers to Suryadev. So Maniman, he becomes arrogant. It seems in the race, something about the race, they are always very offensive towards spiritual people. So this Maniman went to the extent of spitting on the head of Agastya Rishi. So Agastya Rishi looks up to Kuer and he says, for this arrogance, I curse you that Maniman who committed this offense will be defeated. All you yakshas will be defeated by a human being. You all are gods, but you will be defeated by a human being. And therefore, when the Pandavas were in exile, they go towards the Badrik Ashram, that area. And when Bhima was going towards the yaksha, the zone of the yakshas, from where one of the flowers, Saugandhika flower, had come down, which Draupadi liked very much, and she requested Bhima that you please get me one flower. So he went there, and she was stopped by Maniman, attacked him, and Bhima killed him. And immediately Kuer appeared on the scene, and he met with Bhima and embraced him and blessed him. And Bhima asked, how is it that the power of the gods gave way to the power of man? And he said, that was because of the curse which I received from Agastya. Agastya cursed me for that arrogance, for witnessing an offense committed to him. I was told that all the yakshas will be killed by a human. And it will end when you see the man who kills Maniman. And therefore, by seeing you, my curse has been lifted, and therefore now I am freed from the curse. And he goes back. So we see that when there is arrogance, it is followed by some kind of inauspicious result, which brings one down. Puna mushika bhava. So wealth has got various disadvantages. And therefore it is criticized, and it is anartha. Artham nartham bhavaya nityam nasti tatha sukaleshya satyam putradabhi dhana bhajam bhiti sarvatraisha vihariti. Shankaracharya says, artham nartham. Artham is anartha. Bhavaya nityam nasti tatha sukaleshya satyam. That artha is anartha, it has got not an iota of happiness in it. Nasti tatha sukhalesha satyam putradabhi dhana bhajam bhiti sarvatraisha vihariti. A wealthy man is afraid of even his son. Putradabhi dhana bhajam bhiti sarvatraisha vihariti. This is an age old phenomena. It is coming on since time immemorial. It's not new. That a wealthy man is afraid of his own son. Recently there was some article of one lady, Leona Hensky or some lady in America, very wealthy, filthy rich woman, and when she dies, she writes her property. She has children, but she leaves her property to a dog. The dog's name is Trouble. And she writes on her will that when my dog dies, I want him to be buried close to my grave. And the children are angry at the mother that why the mother has not left money for us. Artham nartham bhavaya nityam nasti tata sukaleshya satyam putradabhi dhana bhajam bhiti sarvatraisha vihariti. Artham nartham. Artha is nanartha. That's why I was telling the other day, one student going to college. He just started going to college. Somebody asks him, which is the best book you like? He says, my father's checkbook. That's why the Sufi saint has said, that is the problem, that great kings have come and gone. But where are they today? After they have gone, great kings, but today they are nowhere. Nobody speaks about them. Where is their military strength? Where is their wealth? Where is their bank balance? Today not even a man puts a light on their grave. All those wealthy men, they're all gone. Yaad kar us Sikandar ko hausle to aali the. Jab gaya tha duniya se dono haath khali the. Adna ho ya aala ho sabko laut jana hai. Muflis ho tawangar ka kabar hi thikana hai. You are a wealthy man, you are a poor man, one destination for all. जैसी करनी वैसी भरनी, आज किया कल पाएगा, सर उठा के चलने वाले एक दिन ठोकर खाएगा. सूफी सेंट. सो दिस इज द ट्रुथ. इट हैज बीन सीन एंड ऑब्जर्व्ड दैट वी कैन सी दैट ऑल ग्रेट सेंटली पीपल ट्राई टू अवॉइड द वेल्थ आफ्टर सर्टन पीरियड ऑफ टाइम आफ्टर एंजॉइंग इट. धर्म अर्थ काम मोक्षा. I was recently at one devotee's house and he was telling the story of the guru of Yeshudas. He was a very great singer, very powerful, very melodious singer in South India. His guru was Chembai Vaidyanathan Bhagavatar. Great singer, and he had some few sons who were also great singers. And they were so poverty stricken, they didn't have money. So he told his children that you go and sing and perform some shows and get money. We want around 20,000 rupees. We have to pay back some money or whatever, debts or whatever. They go perform and they get 30,000 rupees. And the children bring it to the father, and the father takes the money and he says, what is this? I told you to bring 20,000. Why have you brought 30,000? And he goes to the organizer and he says, please take back 10,000. We don't want this. Why do we need 30,000? We don't want 30,000. We want 20,000. Why do we need to take another 10,000 rupees? Takes it back. So advanced. Because truly the spiritual seekers, one has to be really advanced to actually see this meaning of what has been spoken. Otherwise one will not understand what are these principles being spoken about. Who will give up wealth? Money is sweeter than honey. Cannot give up. And then one day when he was singing, it is explained, he was singing in front of Guruvayur, and he was singing so melodiously, all of a sudden his voice choked up and he lost his voice. Was completely helpless, and he prayed to Lord Guruvayur that this is the way I serve you. You have taken that away. How can I serve you now? And then after some short period of time, he again got his voice back. So we see that is how it is. The Lord sometimes takes away, gives us. It's all short time. We have all got some abilities. Use it in God's service. Therefore, Prabhu says, na dhanam, na janam, na sundari, kavitam va jagadish kamaye, mama janmani. जन्मनि ईश्वरे भवताद् भक्तिर हेतुकी द्वय त्रिणादपि सुनीचेन तरोरिव सहिष्णुना अमानि नमाने देन कीर्तनीय सदा हरि. दैट वी हैव टू ऑलवेज रिमेंबर दिस दैट ऑल ऑपुलेंसेस आर जस्ट अ गिफ्ट ऑफ गॉड फॉर सम टाइम शॉर्ट पीरियड ऑफ टाइम. एंड देयरफॉर शंकराचार्य सेज मा कुरु धन जन यौवन गर्वम हरति निमेषा काल सर्वम मायामयम इदम अखिलम हित्वा ब्रह्म पदम त्वं प्रवेश विदित्वा. That is all temporary. Ma kuru dhana jana yovana garbam. Never be proud of your wealth, of your beauty. It's all a temporary thing. Harati nimeshat kala sarvam. In a moment it will be taken away. You will not know when it is gone. Maya mayam idam akhilam hitva. So everything is a maya world. Only truth is Krishna. Satyam param dhimahi. That is the truth. The truth in this world is changing. It is the truth. There is truth in this world, but it changes. But param satyam dhimahi. The Lord is satyam param. It's ultimate truth. Never changes. The soul changes. His relationship with God is changeless. And therefore, if one works towards that, then he can attain his true happiness, which we are all looking for. By the chanting of the holy names, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Hare Ram. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Gaur Bhaktavrinda ki jai, Gaur Premanande Hare Hare.